So I think a good place to start is just a bit of context setting around archiving, which probably makes a few of you on the call roll your eyes, because historically, archiving has been a very unsexy term. And it's kind of this perception of archiving that it's this dusty filing cabinet that's at the back of the room where nobody can see it. And people put things in there that they don't really want, but they're just too scared to throw away, right? Well, maybe in the 90s, but the reality is that actually in the last 10 to 15 years, archiving has become a crucially important foundation for any organization in any different shape and size and their approach to governance, risk, and compliance. And I'm sure all of you on this call will know much better than me that having a tight grip on GRC, in particular by controlling how and where data is stored, is probably even more important to offshore organizations such as yourselves than it might be some of your onshore counterparts. Now, because of that, if we don't have an effective strategy for managing things like our client information, our general corporate data, financial records, transaction history, our intellectual property and the like, then we risk data loss. We increase legal risks to our business, which could, of course, lead to reputational damage. And of course, we have the risk of loss of productivity, which might be created by users, IT admins or discovery officers that just can't get the right access to archive data when they need to, you know, whether that's for general day-to-day work or because of a subject access request or any discovery case due to litigation. So the Mimecast Cloud Archive for email was a solution that we built, you know, many years ago and have continued to develop to try to solve these very real and very modern archiving problems. You know, it wasn't just how do we solve a mailbox management problem. It was really about enabling our customers, and in particular our offshore customers, to guarantee that they had a safe offshore repository for their data and the right tools in place to access that data when they need to for compliance, e-discovery, or general day-to-day productivity. And part of the power of that value proposition is that we were able to wrap that up and integrate that within a comprehensive email security and continuity solution, so we could really solve, you know, the three of the main problems that our customers were telling us about many moons ago, which was email security, business continuity, and data archiving. Now, although email is still very much the focus of our business, of course, we're starting to move into areas such as Microsoft Teams. But our actual the mindset and the approach that we take to information archiving stays exactly the same. And it really is just pivoting around these four points that are now on your screen. The first is making sure that we can provide sophisticated e-discovery tools. So compliance officers or discovery officers can effectively search their organization's archive, manage things like legal hold, and run early case assessment. We also want to make sure that we're helping our customers on the journey to achieve compliance. And we do that with things such as our data residency guarantees. So we've spoken a lot about offshore data residency already today. The ability to set minimum retention periods, access logging to identify suspicious behavior and access to the archive, and so on and so forth. Thirdly, we've really tried to bridge the gap between backup and recovery and email archiving, because historically these were seen as two different projects, you know, often managed by two different areas of business. But by allowing our customers to use their archive as a recovery pool as well, and, you know, quickly recover lost data, for example, if a mailbox was corrupted in Office 365, with the right calendars, contacts, folders, and tasks, and we've really been able to bridge the gap between an archive being something that just sits in the way in the corner, versus an archive that actually can act as a backup and recovery repository as well. And because we're doing all three of these things, what we've actually done is made archiving a useful, usable tool that helps maximize productivity. We're giving users different access to different archive data and in different ways. So as an end user, it should be easy for me to access my own email archive from a mobile device with the Outlook plugin. For IT, I might need to look at a certain view of my whole organization's archive information, but it's for recovery purposes. And for a discovery or compliance officer, I might need, you know, a very detailed read access to a very specific person's mailbox because of a litigation case. So we've made sure to provide different tools for different people across the organization so that the archive is actually a really usable tool. Now, all of this is relevant because it demonstrates the very strong background and understanding that we have of the world of enterprise information archiving. And it's for this reason that we were, for the seventh year in a row, named as Gartner's Magic Quadrant leader in this area. So yes, a lot of this is with the background of email, but actually the Microsoft Teams archiving is an extension to those capabilities. So actually it's super relevant to why we're on this call today. So let's get a little bit closer to that story. Now, even before the 2020 pandemic, most of us probably recognized in our own working lives that actually we're in the middle of a shift towards collaboration in the workplace. The days of a single contributor owning a single project with minimum support or input from his or her teammates, it's just on the way out. You know, we really don't work like that anymore in those kind of silo structures. Instead, we're now moving into a world where there's massive dynamic cross-department functionality and cross-department collaboration on our everyday day-to-day work. On top of that, partly because of the pandemic, for many organizations, a work from home or hybrid working structure has now emerged and become the new normal. So when we do collaborate together as teams, it isn't always as simple as popping over to someone else's desk or exchanging notes in a meeting room, or really just catching up about a project around the office's favorite coffee machine or something like that. And what this means is that organizations have needed to find new technologies that help them to adjust to this new collaborative, dynamic and disparate way of working. And the two biggest winners of the race so far are, of course, Zoom, which we're using to present today, and Microsoft Teams. Both of these platforms are well on their way to overtaking email as an organization's primary communications platform. You know, much like email took over the fax machine and the telephone many moons ago. Now, between March 2020 and June of the same year, so the first 3 months of the official pandemic, I suppose, Microsoft Teams grew by nearly 900%. And if you look at a slightly broader range from the back end of 2019 to January 2022, Microsoft has actually added more than 230 million users to their platform. So organizations are embracing these technologies, and they're going to need to continue to do so if they're going to compete in this new world. But if they're going to do so safely, then they're going to have to make sure that they're not introducing new security risks that can otherwise be avoided. The challenge whenever a new technology space emerges, and this collaboration era, if you will, isn't the first and won't be the last evolution of the way that we use tech. And the challenge is, how do we keep the new world just as safe as what come before it? And all of the investment and all the time that we spent keeping our infrastructure safe, how do we make sure we maintain that security in a new world? And because of that, there's a big question mark around how we use Teams safely, and very specifically, what we do with the data that sits behind Teams. Now, this requires visibility and control from an IT perspective. Now, that shadow IT question, of course, but it's also a really important question to ask in terms of legal and compliance. It's not just trivial stuff that's being stored in Microsoft Teams, is it? It really, it's your corporate IP, your intellectual property as an organization. So ultimately, what Teams is doing is giving hackers yet another way to try and exploit your organization by potentially compromising what's the most important thing, which is your data. So we have to really carefully think about how we store this data. It's a really important question to ask ourselves. So why would I suddenly want to think about archiving Teams, or actually anything for that matter? Well, as we just touched on, Teams has kind of become the new email, certainly in terms of being a quick and efficient way to have a conversation with a colleague, a customer, or a business partner. And very much like email in the early noughties, maybe late 90s, the kind of data that's being exchanged is growing all the time. Because as I just said, we're not just using it as an SMS platform, are we? How many of us on this call, for example, have exchanged documents regarding a project that we're working on with a colleague? Or discussed new customers, a merger and acquisition? Spoken with a client externally about something that we might be working on as a collaboration? And how much of those conversations are happening on Microsoft Teams? Now, don't be shy about admitting it. It's literally what the platform was made for. But once we do recognize that we are having business conversations on Microsoft Teams, we have to recognize that therefore it's corporate data. And if it's corporate data, then compliance is top of the agenda. And compliance has for a long time been the number one reason that an organization thinks about and later invests in an archiving solution. The value proposition from technology vendors like Mimecast is something like, we can help you to store the data that you need to keep in the location that you want, for the duration of time that you want, often in the format that you want, and with the level of encryption that you need, and with the right access controls around it, and so on and so forth. And the reason that we do that is to help you comply with any number of compliance requirements that you're subjected to in terms of how you store and manage your data. Now, that might be fairly general, like I'll guarantee the data won't leave the offshore grid, for example, which many of the customers on this call today will already appreciate. Or it might be more specific, such as GDPR or CCPA, or maybe something even more laser focused than that, like an industry specific regulation for finance house or an insurance brokers, for example. But these aren't email only concerns, are they? They're familiar concerns. They're conversations that we've already had with ourselves many times, including about email data, but it's now just spreading across into this new technology stack, into the Microsoft Teams world. And the research by Osterman, which you can see on your screens, and we will happily share this deck with you afterwards, which will include links if you want to see this information, demonstrates that there is concern around compliance in Microsoft Teams. And actually, there's lots of appetite in the marketplace to close some of the gaps around compliance that are found within the native capabilities out of the box in Office 365. So just like many of us had a conversation with ourselves 5 years ago about moving to 365 as to whether it was okay just to keep everything with Microsoft, same conversations are around now. It's really important that we're thinking carefully about what resilience we can wrap around our investment in Microsoft products. So that's compliance. What about e-discovery? Because another byproduct of the COVID-19 pandemic is that it seems to have accelerated what was already an increasing frequency of litigation that was being instigated by and against organizations of various different shapes and sizes. Excuse me. In particular, there's an uptick in litigation regarding things like employment discrimination, unfair hiring and firing, and the application of different COVID-19 relief packages that are often state-backed. Increased litigation means that organizations will need to deploy their e-discovery tools and strategies on a more frequent basis. Now, it's worth noting that when Mimecast emerged as an archiving solution in the early 2000s, when we met up with Polly and began to crusade around the Caribbean, electronic discovery was kind of a new thing that was starting to be on the rise. And certainly it was a very early period in which email was on the microscope. But organizations with a kind of dusty far-room approach to archiving were really struggling to respond. And what helped us emerge was our ability to actually provide these e-discovery tools to customers to help them get access to that data that was previously just put away and hopefully never needed. So just like compliance that we spoke about a couple of slides ago, we have a familiar challenge, but it's just in a slightly new guise. You know, e-discovery is not a new problem. It's a familiar problem that's now transcending across email and chat. The research by Osterman shows that actually nearly half e-discovery requests now require access to Microsoft Teams content. Again, it just makes sense really, doesn't it? If this platform's gone from 45 million users to 275 million users in just over a year, then suddenly it's obvious that Teams is a platform in which most organizations are exchanging ideas and intellectual property, discussing transactions, talking to suppliers, negotiating with external companies, and so on and so forth. So of course, Teams data is going to come under the legal microscope when we think about litigation. But if you're wondering or looking for some more specific examples of where Microsoft Teams data might be included in the e-discovery case, then I've got four more fairly broad examples for you. So firstly, we have HR disputes. And we kind of touched on this just a moment ago. There's been a big uptick of litigation around hiring and firing behaviors since the start of the pandemic. And making crucial decisions about who to bring on board to an organization and who that's already, you know, within our company that we retain, is that they're generally complicated decisions. And they're very rarely made autonomously by a single person. These discussions are discussed at length over email, over the phone, in meeting rooms, and you guessed it, via Microsoft Teams. So it's really important that we can capture all of these conversations in case we do face an e-discovery case regarding to our hiring and firing behaviors or general HR queries. Secondly, we can think about workplace violations. Now, yes, Teams was created as a collaboration platform for work, but ultimately it is an instant messaging platform. So we know that users are, of course, are going to use it to talk about their weekends, to engage in office gossip. Perhaps it's a forum for the early exchanges of the latest office romance. And I can say that with a bit of a giggle because, you know, I am marrying somebody that I work with at Minecraft. Not to mention Teams might be used for the dark arts of every organization's office politics. So we know that this platform might be misused. And because of that, organizations have to think very carefully about whether they're adequately protecting their employees from harassment, bullying, or generally from being in an unfair or unsafe work environment because of the lack of visibility over these internal teams communications. Thirdly, if we continue to look at our employees, then we can think about investigations against our employees. And here in particular, I'm thinking about the stories that you hear all the time about malicious or careless insiders. Now, 71% of organizations admit to having an insider who deliberately tried to damage the reputation or property of their organization. And often this is due to the use or misuse or theft of corporate data. Now, organizations like yourselves have spent a long time thinking about this in different contexts, you know, email and web, for example. We know that we can restrict access to things like Google or Dropbox to stop people dropping corporate data in those locations. They could even set up DLP controls on their email client to prevent somebody actually being able to share stuff externally that they shouldn't. But most importantly, I think most organizations now feel fairly confident that if somebody did try to share or leak external information externally or steal property, then they'd at least have a number of controls in place to try and figure that out, in best case before it happens or certainly after the fact, so this activity could in fact be tracked. Are we really confident that we have the same visibility and control in Microsoft Teams yet? If the answer is no, then this is obviously another really, really important reason to think, should I be archiving this data and actually make sure that I have a second microscope, a second lens to glance over this growing platform? Finally, policy violations regarding the use of work materials or access to documents and things like that. Again, this could be tightly controlled using the previous generation of collaboration tools. For example, the chain of custody around email messaging is something that Mimecast has always taken very similar in the email space. But it's very important actually that we have the same confidence, that we have the same visibility and control over Microsoft Teams, particularly if we're asked to prove it. That's another really good example of why e-discovery is potentially such a problem that's looming. So how should you respond to the growing number of e-discovery queries? Now requesting access from even more repositories of electronic data, including Microsoft Teams, up to 50% of the time, as we saw a couple of slides ago. Well, one strategy is you could just try self-collection. And yep, I literally mean just let users collect information themselves if there is any discovery case and forward it on to whoever they're asked to. Search through their personal chat history, essentially. That's a cheap and cheerful approach, but I'm sure it doesn't take a huge amount of reflection to acknowledge that it's almost certainly going to be inaccurate. And it's definitely very unlikely to stand up to legal scrutiny. So, that's definitely not the strategy that's going to work. Many organizations may turn to a third-party consultant who specializes in e-discovery. But the chances are this is going to be very expensive. The service offerings vary wildly. And actually, most of the research suggests that you'll often end up with a quite an over-engineered and over-complicated solution to what should be a very simple exercise of actually just extracting information that you've correctly stored away from your different communications platforms. Now, the third solution is where we fit. And that's by moving e-discovery into IT, by leveraging a best-of-breed archiving solution that includes the ability to store and search Microsoft Teams data. Operationally then, e-discovery simply becomes part of the predictable infrastructure cost that most customers and most of the people on this call, I'm sure, have incrementally been building into their OPEX budgets during the shift to the cloud over the last few years anyway. So we can really operationalize this e-discovery problem, both in terms of the process by moving it under IT, but also from a budgetary perspective by moving it under infrastructures. And that's exactly why we built the Mimecast Archive for Teams product. We already have our best of breed capabilities in email archiving, and we've now expanded those capabilities to include Microsoft Teams data. So that familiar industry recognized archiving compliance and e-discovery tool set that many of the customers on this call already have, but certainly anyone that doesn't, we can learn about on subsequent calls, can now sit across multiple data outlets. And the two of the fastest growing data outlets in our business in email and Microsoft Teams. This will allow you to therefore keep a consolidated view of all of your communications archives, as well as giving that second layer of resilience around the latest addition to M365. Most importantly, though, it's going to guarantee that the data that's collected in Microsoft Teams is kept safe where customers want it and made available when they need it. And for our offshore customers, That means that we can guarantee that your Microsoft Teams data is going to stay offshore on the grid that's managed by our partners over at Shure Business. And that's for your Microsoft Teams information, just in the same way that for many of you, we've been archiving your email data. So as a brief summary then, before I pass over to Rob, we've covered three fairly broad but really, really important reasons actually, that it's important to think carefully about how you now look after Microsoft Teams data, if that's the solution that you're going to use moving forwards. Firstly, we recognize that Teams usage is simply exploding, which means that the data collected behind it includes plenty of our intellectual property. And this is corporate data. It needs to be stored away very carefully, much like in the early days of email when it stopped becoming an SMS platform and actually became our core communications platform. One of the main reasons that we need to do this is because of compliance. All organizations of different shapes and sizes are under pressure to keep corporate data in specific locations within specific regulations, however broad and narrow. Productivity toolkits by M365 weren't built for compliance, but they're productivity toolkits. Archiving solutions were literally created for this purpose. And then we talked at length about the challenge of e-discovery and the different reasons that you might be called on to run an e-discovery exercise and some of the strategies that you could use to deal with it. We think that the right balance between productivity, accuracy, and legal risk management, that GRC question that we started with, is to make e-discovery part of IT. And since Mimecast are already recognized as Gartner's leading information archiving solution, because of our background in email, our archive for Microsoft Teams is well placed to help with this. So that's my brief, quite a thorough introduction, I guess, about the why and a little bit about the what. But I think the best way to talk to you about the product is really to start to have a look at the how. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce my colleague, Rob Wiltshire. And what Rob's going to do by a combination of PowerPoint and also some live demoing, if customers want to see it, and if you're interested in seeing it after the end of the presentation, he's actually going to show you Archive for Teams as a solution in action and talk a little bit about their implementation. So Rob, over to you, my friend.
Perfect. Thank you very much, David. So with Microsoft Teams, this is an add-on product for the archiving, and it integrates in with the archive via the case review application. The main use case for this product is around e-discovery, as the product will allow businesses to respond swiftly to governance events, which could consist of internal or external litigation, as well as compliance requests such as SARs or right to be forgotten. And really, by using this tool to complete the requests, it allows the administrators to carry out the searches for these requests with ease and turns what could be a lengthy task into a matter of minutes. One of the biggest benefits we see with really using this tool is when conducting searches for the Teams data is you would perform the search in exactly the same way in which if you were to be performing an archive search. You would be given the same search parameters, which would allow you to apply the same granularity when searching for that Teams, when searching for those Teams conversations, sorry. This allows the keywords to be highlighted during the searches and as well having the ability to save that search and add them into an active case for further reviewing. When performing searches for e-discovery, it allows you to see what was happening in that conversation and around that time, which really allows the relevant conversation to be identified. As well as when performing searches, we can pull the entire conversation. It's not just a search result, just a search that we actually show. We will show the before and the after of the conversation. So you're able to actually get a full context of really what was actually being said. And once we've actually completed all the searches, all of this data can then actually be exported out of the console for a further review if necessary. So now obviously once we've opened up one of the conversations and what we're presented with is actually the message summary. So within the actual conversation, it will give you the sender, it will give you the recipients, it will say when the actual message was sent, the message type, etc. And what we're also capturing is exposure. So it actually allows you to see if the recipient was internal and if there was anyone actually external to that conversation. So for instance, when performing a search for an attachment name, setting the exposure to say external recipients. This will give you the search results. And what it will do is it will actually, you'll be able to have that confirmation that no one externally has received that particular attachment. We do support exports of the conversation. So you would be able to produce that a search against the Teams data, select the conversation you wish to export, hit the export button, and we will get this process for you. It really does become very relevant with when organizations are receiving, say, DSAR requests, where we are seeing a real broadening of language. So historically, organizations would receive requests to, say, export all of Mr. X's email data from the last 6 months. So administrators would go into the application, they would produce the searches for the requests and export this data to PSD and share with the requester. And by that point, the job would be done. But now they're requesting all of the actual communication data for this user. For however long, it really is stated in the actual the request that they receive. This really could actually turn into quite a lengthy task without the correct tools. However, this really can be easily achieved within the tool by performing an archive search for all of the email data for that date period, and then performing all of the archive searches for the Teams data. And then all of this data can then be exported out all in one go. And it really does make light work of the request. So now we've really talked about a lot of the benefits around using the tool. I'm just going to cover a little bit around the implementation side of things. And we've really made it nice and effortless for you guys if you were to obviously look at actually ever implementing this product. And typically the way it works is that under the services section, you would just need to go into the actual, into the connections, choose Mimecast archiving for Microsoft Teams, log in using your Office 365 administrator account. This account would just need to have a global administrator account. You would give it a name, a description, and there we go. That's the setup done. And what we were able to do is the connector will then run in the background and all of that historical data then will be ingested automatically. And no further action is actually required from yourself. We handle the rest of it. So with regards to going forwards, when you're performing these e-discovery requests for, say, Teams data, you've got that data ingested in without actually needing to lift a finger. So now I'm just going to hand back over to David just to cover off some of the key takeaways from this.
Perfect. Thanks, Rob.
No trouble at all.
So in terms of key takeaways, just before we move to Q&A and in the next steps, we recognize that we're in an era of collaboration, right? It's a new era of the way that we use IT, and Teams is very much front and center as probably one of the two, if not the most dominant communications tool within this new era of collaboration. That's fantastic, but it does create risks, and those risks don't sit in one place. They actually transcend across IT, legal and compliance. And it's very important that we're careful about how we mitigate these risks, in particular with regards to how we store, manage and use the data that sits behind this new communications platform. Archive for Microsoft Teams by Mimecast makes governance and e-discovery easy, just like we do for email. And that really is the important part of the message here. You know, our record as Gartner's leading archive for enterprise information allows us to be in a really, really fantastic position to support here. So it's about leveraging their existing capabilities, moving them across into a new discourse for Microsoft Teams. And that's really the key value proposition that we're keen to discuss with you all today. So I'm going to stop there.